Our world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, SLC TV will feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair, because the lecture hall is about to begin.
It's always an exciting opportunity for me to come here and talk with the audience at the Manatee Center. We have been doing programs for years and years. We work together on summer camps and the lunch and learn session. Of course, George and I go back all the way back from before the center was open. I'd also like to acknowledge some of our volunteers that we have here today. Marsha Kopp, who is going to be presenting a little bit later on. Carl, who is over here, and Jerry in the back, and all of you guys will have. And then we have Tessa, who actually works here, but she's a master naturalist. Aaron in the back. And then we have Jill Arnold, who works at the Oxbow Eco Center. So any of us here could probably help you out with a little bit more information about extension and extension programs if you needed them. How many of you have heard about coyotes in the Treasure Coast? How many of you have actually heard them howling?
I've seen them.
You've seen them? Yeah.
They went across the road up here.
Yeah, we see them. Sometimes we see them, but we're not really hearing them, right? Unless you're out west of town where there aren't a lot of people, they don't vocalize quite so much. Could we have the lights turned down, please? So what we're going to do, and also how many of you have heard about the coyote issues that have been in the news this year about the dogs and stuff being eaten down in Boca and some of that happened on the West Coast? We're going to talk about all of that. And here in St. Lucie County, the potential is there for the same sort of issue to occur. So basically what our program is today, we're going to teach you about coyote, the biology, the management, the range expansion throughout Florida, and then we'll talk about some projects that the master naturalists have taken on over the last couple of years. So what do you see about this picture? It's a beach. What else do you see? A big hole. And what else do you see? A big pile of sea turtle eggs that have been chewed on. That was done by a coyote. And it was done by a coyote here in St. Lucie County. For the first time last year, we had coyote predation on sea turtle nests in St. Lucie County. We'll talk all about that today. So these are my co-presenters, Marsha Kopp, who is going to be up a little bit later on, Jerry Bott, Melissa Jansen, who is not here today. She's here in spirit. We're going to look at a video and some of the slides that she produced for a final project she worked on. And Luann Hastings, who also helped out with this project. And I have to also acknowledge Dr. Marnie Main, who helped us with some of the content in this video. So the topics we're going to talk about is biology, range expansion in Florida, the Coyote Watch program that we have here. And you'll notice that in extension, what we do is we study and we help produce outreach. We conduct outreach. So we're not the ones out there that are actually managing coyotes. I'm on faculty at the University of Florida. I work for St. Lucie County, but neither I or none of the volunteers that work with the Master Naturalist program or 4-H, none of us are out there actually managing the coyotes. It's up to the property owners or property managers to figure out if anything needs to be done. We're just there to provide information on how all this stuff can be done. So a little bit about coyote biology. They are the same genus as our regular house dogs that we're familiar with. Canis is the genus. However, the species is different. Latrans is the species for a coyote, and that basically means barking dog. So Canis latrans is the barking dog, it is the coyote. Whereas our house dogs that we're all familiar with, Canis familiaris, and so we have the same genus, and they look very similar, behaviors are different, and there are some very different tracks and things that they produce. And their behavior is very different. We'll see a video a little bit later on that shows how that behavior is different. The adults are about the size of a medium-sized dog, and the ones that we've seen here are less than waist high, and we have some photos to show you to give you kind of a size comparison. Their natural area is about 15 miles squared. In urban areas, it runs to be about 3 miles squared. And when we're on Hutchinson Island, whether it's north or south, you know that it's probably even smaller area than that, because the island itself is maybe not even a quarter of a mile wide in some areas. So they do have the ability to shrink their domain. We also have coyotes in the savannas. And here in St. Lucie County, the savannas runs 10 miles. So that does produce, it does provide quite a bit of habitat for coyotes to live in. They are omnivorous. They will eat pretty much anything a dog will eat. And we know that a dog, if it gets a chance, will get into the trash. They eat fruit, eggs, you know, meat, any of that stuff. And I actually have a comparison of what coyotes eat versus bobcats. So we'll see a little bit more about their diet. They use all landscapes, from urban areas, even the beaches, all the way out to the cattle ranches out west of town. And their social groups tend to be familiar. So you've got a family size group. You'll have a mama and a papa, and then probably up to six little pups. And that tends to be the family group, and then the pups eventually start to branch out on their own. So they don't work in packs like we're familiar with wolves. Their familiar groupings are just basically mom, dad, and some of the young. Both parents will feed or will care for the young. Breeding will take place early in the year, January, February. Gestation is about 2 months long, and the average litter is about 3 to 6 pups. The pups emerge from the den after about 4 to 5 weeks. They're weaned off of the mother's milk within 2 to 3 months, and they disperse at 4 to 10 months. And there is a little bit of information in the literature about coyote-wolf hybrids and coyote-dog hybrids. Generally, they are sterile when that happens. And a lot of the reason why the coyotes and dogs don't necessarily mate is the estrus cycles don't match up completely. The estrus cycle for wolves tends to be earlier in the year, for coyotes, tends to be earlier in the year, and dogs, it's a little bit different throughout the year. And also, coyotes look at dogs as if they were food. So the mating, obviously right there's a reason why the mating doesn't occur, because the dogs are food for the coyotes. But it has happened, and there is some literature out there. When it does happen, they're sterile offspring. Eradication of wolves is probably one of the primary reasons for expansion of coyote into Florida. We're not bringing them in. A lot of invasive species, non-native species that make it here to Florida, they're here because we bring them in. In the case of coyotes, they've worked their way here on their own. People are not bringing them here and releasing them. They have naturally expanded their territory throughout most of the peninsula, throughout the entire peninsula and down into the Keys, but not all the way down in the Keys. You know, we used to actually have wolves. We used to have black bears here. Back in the early pioneer days, you could expect to find black bears on North and South Hutchinson Island. And then people moved in and the black bears were all, you know, hunted and taken off the property. So all these animals that used to be here before man, that opens up a little bit of an itch. And wolves being one of them. And coyotes have kind of filled the remnants of those niches.
Is that the red wolf?
The red wolf. I think they had two species of wolves here. I'd have to look it up, though. I think they had two. They had two species here. I'd have to look it up. Yeah. And then also agricultural lands will aid in the distribution of coyotes. They will prey on the wildlife and the animals that live on these agricultural lands. So all of this has helped open up niches for coyotes to move in. So back in the early 1983, it was actually a little earlier than this, they started doing some research and they were finding a little bit of the history of the spread of coyotes through the state. The range expanded into the Florida Panhandle in the 1960s, and then ever since then they've slowly worked their way down throughout the entire Panhandle. And they've gone as far south as Key Largo. And I wouldn't be surprised if they make it eventually down to the Keys. They're very, are down to Key West. They're very adaptive animals. You can see them walking on the streets. As long as there's food source there and land for them to live on, they're likely to expand their territory. And Key Largo is the furthest southern observation, and they found those in 2011. So the way they monitor for coyotes is by looking for tracks. And that's actually one of the strategies that we use when we're monitoring for coyotes. We will look for roadkill. We'll look for carrion. We'll look for animals that have been preyed on. When coyotes have preyed on goats or sheep or anything like that, they usually go for the neck. And they'll bring the animal down that way. So there are very distinctive looks, appearances, things that happen when coyotes prey on animals. And we also use tracks. And what we can do is we can have a specific area that has the sand or the soil bare, and you just rake it over. And then every once in a while, every week or so, you just go and you check for any tracks that have come through. And then you can also use baits. And the baits that we normally recommend, you can actually buy coyote urine. How many of you have ever seen that for sale? Yeah, you can go online. You can probably go to a garden center, maybe even Bass Pro Shop or someplace, and you can buy coyote urine. And what they recommend that you do is get some ceramic tiles and just soak it with coyote urine, and that will probably do a good job of attracting them in if they're in an area. The other thing you can do is get sardines, a can of sardines, but you want it packed in oil and not packed in water. And you can use the same tile technique with this. And what you'll do is you'll crack the little top of the sardine can open and then puncture the side with a nail and then just suspend it through the little hole from a rope. And you suspend it high enough so the coyote can't jump and get it, and let it splash down onto a tile or some rocks. And that oil with the sardine smell is one lure that can help attract a coyote in. So once you do that, you look for the tracks. And the tracks are very distinctive. And it's not easy to identify tracks, especially if you're on sand. When we were working on the island, it was very difficult because what happens is the sand tends to kind of separate out, and then it washes out very easily in our afternoon rains. But the coyotes have very distinct paw print. Usually they have the two little nail prints, and then they're very small and compact. Whereas dogs, when a dog is on sand, their paws tend to spread out a little bit more. And I have a slide a little bit later on where you'll actually see I've taken that graphic with the coyote paw print and I've matched it up to the actual picture of a coyote print that we saw in the wild. And you'll see that it looks exactly like that. So coyotes, we have the good, the bad, and the ugly. And we're trying to be as impartial as possible with this. We don't want everybody to go out and hate coyotes. We don't want everybody to go out and love coyotes. Our job here is to just basically teach you the basics of coyote biology. And the good of them, obviously, they look cute. You know, they look cute. And I think sometimes people mistake coyotes and their cuteness for our house dogs, the regular dogs that we're all familiar with. And the behavior is not the same. You don't want to ever do that. And I remember seeing a video, I think it was last year, where a coyote was stuck underneath the Lake Worth Bridge. And what was probably happening is the coyote was coming over the bridge, or was swimming across the inlet down there, and then got stuck in one of the tides. And somebody actually went underneath it on video and picked the coyote up and moved the coyote out. And that's probably wasn't the smartest thing in the world to do. I would have probably secured the mouth and done something to provide safety for myself. But they do look cute, and people do mistake them for our regular house dogs. They do control smaller predators, and we have opossums, which will prey on eggs of birds and other animals out there that are desirable. Raccoons, they'll also prey on foxes and our domestic cats, and of course, they'll eat some mice. So coyote's the bad, and that almost looks like it looks almost like he's being kind of naughty right there. They can deplete deer herds. And here in St. Lucie County, that is one of the concerns that cattle ranchers have. When you talk to the cattle ranchers and ask them, well, how much livestock loss have you actually suffered? They either can't tell you or they're very hesitant to tell you. And one of the reasons is because when the coyotes prey on, especially newborns, if there's a foal that's just been newborn, the coyotes get in there, there's not much that's left. You can't really tell exactly how many animals you had out there that were actually preyed on, because bones for all that stuff is either consumed or it's not there long enough, the environment breaks it down. So it's very hard to tell what sort of impact the coyotes are actually having. They can estimate it with livestock. We have a hard time getting the actual numbers, but with wildlife, there's an assumption there's an issue, but we can't really put the numbers on it. And up in southeastern Idaho, they did a study and they showed that it was marginal impact. There was an impact that was occurring, but it was something that could be overlooked. They do compete with native predators, the Florida panther, and there was actually a Florida panther that ate one. So a Florida panther ate a coyote. So I actually have, hey Carl, do you want to pass out? I've got some towels here, so we can kind of pass those around. I didn't make the towels myself, I bought them. You can actually go on Amazon.com, and for $20, you can buy a whole shipment of, you can buy a box of coyote towels and they mail them right to you. If you're so inclined, I know you're probably gonna buy a couple of crates. They do compete with other native wildlife, bobcats being one. And you can see here that their diets do overlap just a little bit. when you're looking at armadillos, the coyotes will prey on armadillos, the bobcats will not. The rabbits, they will tend to prey on rabbits. Rodents, by far, bobcats will eat far more rodents than coyotes will. Ungulates, who knows what an ungulate is? And Jill, don't answer this. Who knows what it, yes? Hoofed animals, yep. Ungulates, they will eat ungulates. And that is what coyotes tend to prey on. Sheep, goats, foals. Birds will be preyed on by bobcats, and then coyotes will eat fruit. The bobcats, of course, they're meat only. So that's how their diets differ. Some of the human conflicts that we have, obviously they do prey on livestock. And we've had a difficult time getting a hold of the actual numbers, but there is some research and we've passed out information on that. Cattle ranchers have noted an increase in the number of losses that they're experiencing over time, and I would assume that that trend is going to continue. So as coyotes just continue to increase in numbers, they're going to be taking down more livestock. But once again, it's going to be difficult to determine exactly how much livestock is going to be impacted, because usually we're dealing with herds on a very large piece of acreage, and when coyotes come in and prey on newborns, they get just about all of it. It's very hard to see any remnant to take numbers. And coyotes the ugly, and I'm going to show you a video clip here in just a second. We've seen the news clips down in Boca Raton, and it's also happened over on the West Coast, where people have been living in the western fringe of the community, and they've had reports of coyotes coming up behind the pet owners as they're walking their dogs. Coyotes come up behind, they grab the pet on the leash and just keep going. And they'll actually eat the dog because at that point it's just food for them. And when I'm working with the Coyote Watch team, and we'll have members of that team up here in just a minute, when we're working with the members of the Coyote Watch team, one of the questions that we had is, well, what about the pythons? We've heard about pythons, right, being in the Everglades. We're members of the Python Patrol here also. We've heard that the pythons in the Everglades are taking out a lot of the wildlife in pockets in the Everglades. And when we're talking about removing populations of wildlife, like 99% of the birds, mammals, and other animals that are near the ground are being eaten by these large invasive reptiles like Burmese pythons. But it's only in pockets. And it just so happens to be that the communities where we're seeing a lot of the coyote activity and predation on dogs, it happens to be on that western fringe where it abuts the Everglades. So when you start thinking about the two things, it's like, well, is there a relationship? And when I talk to the specialists that are working on python issues, they say, well, it could be a correlational relationship, which what that means is it could indicate that there is something going on, but we actually have to do research to figure it out. So you would assume that if there's no prey animals, and whether it's armadillos or small animals, rabbits, whatever it might be, you can assume that if the pythons are eating all that up, the coyotes are gonna have to move. The coyotes would also probably be a meal for a python out in the Everglades. So when they're finding these coyotes in the western fringe of the communities down in Boca and so forth, they're usually pretty sickly looking, malnourished, and I think that's exactly what's happened, is they're moving out of the Everglades area and they're pushing their way into the suburban areas. And people are probably feeding them because they look like cute dogs, and they're probably also walking their dogs on long leashes. And if you have a coyote coming up behind you and you have a toy dog, whether it's a Pomeranian, whatever it might be, on a leash, an extendable leash, the coyote comes, grabs that, and then the leash just keeps going. The momentum is there. So even if you went like that, you couldn't pull the dog back. So anyhow, so what I'm gonna do, I'm going to show you a video.
Right off the top at 6, fear in one South Florida community after two beloved pets are attacked by coyotes. It's a problem that continues to grow in a West Boca Raton neighborhood. Coyotes roaming the streets.
And in the latest case, a beloved Yorkie was snatched from its owner while out for a walk. Local 10 News reporter Terrell Fournet live now with our top story at 6. Terrell.
Yeah, Kevin and Lori, the most recent sighting happened just today here in this residential neighborhood, but there have been others in Broward, Dade, and even as far south as Key Largo. And even wildlife experts say that these run-ins with these wild animals are becoming more frequent. Coyotes caught on tape rummaging through trash.
Get out of here.
And residential warning signs are becoming a familiar yet scary sight for people in West Boca Raton.
The coyote came from that direction, circled us once, and grabbed her by the neck. And she was on a leash.
Jill Putney's run-in with the wild animal happened just this morning as she walked her 10-pound pooch inside of the Timberwalk development.
Coyote had a pretty strong hold on her, and somehow the latch got loose, and the coyote took off with my dog.
Her screams and the dog's cries got the attention of neighbor Chris Lowenthal, who took off at high speed, running after the coyote.
The second time when it dropped it and I was able to pick it up, the dog, I had it in my firm grip on the dog, and it wouldn't get it back from me. You know?
But the coyote followed you.
It did. Followed me back into the neighborhood.
Carried the dog back to me, and in tow was the coyote. Came back, like clawing at his back.
Neighbors helped to scare off the hungry animal.
That's great, isn't it?
Chris is being credited for saving the dog's life. They are fortunate, considering another dog was killed in a separate coyote attack nearby over the weekend.
My last vision of the coyote and my dog was her hanging out of the coyote's jaws.
FWC says we as humans must learn to adjust to a species that's here to stay.
Make loud noises, keep the food out of the coyote's accessibility. That's what's really going to prevent them from being there.
So neighbors here on high alert tonight. Jill says that she is calling this the worst experience of her life, fear that she cannot put into words. She's been told, though, that her dog isn't out of the woods just yet after undergoing hours of surgery. And we also know that the Homeowners Association here is bringing in a trapper first thing tomorrow morning to try to catch that wild coyote. We're live in Boca Raton tonight. I'm Terrell Fournet, Local 10 News.
So that was just one incident, but there have been others within the last year, not only on this coast, but also on the west coast of Florida. So it's something that we need to be aware of. And for those of us that are pet owners, we need to be able to deal with, you know, the realization that coyotes are here. So regarding dog attacks versus coyote attacks on people, by far there are more domestic dog attacks on people. And with coyotes, there are only 3.3 attacks per year in the entire U.S., whereas in the U.S. for domestic dogs, it's over 1,000. So, and that's per day, 1,000 emergency visits per day. There are far more domestic dog bites and injuries than there are caused by coyotes. Some advice for you is never feed coyotes or any wild animal for that matter. Prevent access to garbage and pet food. If your trash is being picked up, don't put your trash out overnight. If it gets picked up the next morning, put it out the next morning. Just get up a little bit earlier. It'll also help create a situation where other dogs and things don't knock it down, raccoons don't knock it down, and create a mess for you to pick up. So try to put your trash out as close to the time when it's picked up as possible. Keep cats indoors and watch small dogs when they're out. Wave arms, shout, and act aggressively if a coyote ever comes up to you. And if they ever approach, lift small pets up and be prepared to defend yourself. And then that thing about the coyotes on retractable leashes, I would consider maybe getting a different type of leash. So who should you contact when there is a problem? There's a trapper's list that's online. And the nice thing about this trapper's list is you can sort it out by county, and you can even sort it out by type of animal that you need trapper help with. As far as hunting, coyotes have no season. There is no bag limit in Florida. They may be taken by all lethal means, as long as it's not considered to be inhumane. They're considered fur bearers, and they can be trapped. Coyotes can be hunted on private land year-round without permission, or with permission. There's no permitting that's needed. from the state. And there are wildlife management areas throughout the state, and you can see them on this map, including some in our general area. So, Jerry, at this point, I'm gonna invite Jerry Bott up. And Jerry Bott was the project manager for a master naturalist project that Melissa Jansen worked on.
As Ken said, I was fortunate to be the project manager for Melissa Jansen, whose picture is down in the corner. Melissa was taking a master naturalist class, and she was interested in doing some work on coyotes. And because we had been doing coyote monitoring out on the beach, we decided to include her in this. But not, actually, she lives out west, so the beach wasn't going to work for her. So she went out in the western part of the county. And we had two goals for this. One half of the project was research. And Melissa worked on a study, which we then distributed through Ken and through some other means to ranchers in the area. And we tried to get an idea of predation and loss. And as Ken said, it was very difficult to do because, as one rancher told me, cows are out there, and other than a few ranches that have really high dollar cattle, generally the cows are out and they get by on their own, and there's not a lot of care taken. It's not you know, like a dairy farm in the Midwest where they interact with them every day. So so we didn't get as useful of conclusions as we wanted. The other half was Melissa wanted to get some video of coyotes, and you know, pictures are always great, just like Ken's news story. We always want to see what we're looking for. So we tried a number of means. First off, what we thought, we got access to Eves Ranch. Rancher Buzz Eves was very kind to allow us pretty much any access we wanted in order to do this. And the first plan was to use game cameras like you would find in Cabela's or Bass Pro. And we put those out with some bait, and the results are pretty much what you see here as far as the pictures we got, meaning nothing. Coyotes are smart animals. If you think about what a dog can do, what a dog can be trained to do, obviously they're bright animals. And when we talked to trappers, they said there's all kinds of issues in trying to successfully bait a coyote with food. So we moved on a little bit, and Melissa was very resourceful, so she enlisted her husband to help her out early in the morning. He's making coffee for their run to go out, because they were going to try, rather than having a remote camera over some bait, the next plan was to use a game caller. And the way most coyote hunters work is they use a automated game caller that has a recording of some type of noise that will draw a coyote. Coyotes are opportunistic eaters, so if they hear a distress call from a rabbit or something else, they come in and investigate and see if it's a free and easy meal. So they had the game caller, and then out near her house, they went out and used a tree stand and video camera to try and get this coyote video. It actually worked in the end. I don't know if we're to the video yet.
I think they have the video camera set up on the next.
Yeah, so this is the view going out there. So you can see limitations. This wasn't where they had a giant zoom lens on there. But if you see sort of directly over the camera and headed out, there was the game caller out there. And they had distress rabbit cries, which sort of a little squeaky sort of cry. And then they also had a squirrel tail lure. This thing's got a little arm on it that waves a little tail around. And so you have the visual and oral attraction to the coyote. And that was the plan. So they went out there and they sat there. I can't remember how many days they did this, but
let's just say that she earned her certificate.
Yes, she did. This poor woman, she worked awful hard to get this. And again, you can see a close-up of the tree stand. They're well camouflaged, so that they don't scare the coyote off. In her success, what Melissa got was video, and when we hit play, what you're gonna see is this very rapid movement as you look at it from right to left. But we're gonna have to show this like three times so you can catch this, because this guy comes flying through.
And that was it.
Did you get it? You can just
Yeah.
It's there. She worked hard for this.
It's so faint, it's back there. But rest assured, a coyote did run through. Let me go back one more time. Yeah, and I mean, he just shoots across there. So that's real.
I don't mean to intentionally torture my students. It just happens that way.
Yeah. It's obviously with the limitations of the lens that she had, it's tougher to see on video, but it was quick. And the coyote did not stop. I mean, on the fly, it came past, apparently realized that there was no real food there and just kept on trucking as fast as it could go. So she was successful. And the project really was successful in both ways. As Ken said, what we do with the survey is we're trying to get data here. We're trying to find out what we know and what we don't know about coyotes in the area.
So for those of you that might not be familiar with the Florida Master Naturalist Program, it is a University of Florida program we offer here in St. Lucie County. I have programs at the Extension Office. And we also have some folks at Savannah's Preserve down in St. Lucie County, Port St. Lucie. And hopefully we're going to be bringing on board Smithsonian to do some coastal work with us. So we've got things in the works here in St. Lucie County. As part of their training, master naturalists are required to undertake a final project. And in this particular case, poor Melissa Jansen ended up, I think she learned more about coyotes and people's perceptions of coyotes than she had ever imagined she would. And she was very determined to get to the bottom of what's going on with the cattle ranchers. But the frustration that she kept running into is, you know, getting actual numbers. And the ranchers were all telling us, yes, we're seeing impacts, we know the coyotes are a problem, but when it actually came down to numbers, they were a little bit hesitant to give those numbers to us. And when we started talking to some of the opinion leaders amongst the cattle industry here in the area, they were telling us that when you say the percent of cattle predation on livestock, that's basically saying how much money they have. So they're very hesitant to talk about, you know, how much money they have in their livestock. So, you know, that was one of the things that she ran into a little bit of problems with. And as far as the video goes, she tried very hard. We put those cameras out, and if you've ever seen a trail camera when it's used, you're not seeing a bright light when it's put out in the evening and you have an animal that goes in front of the trail cam. All you see is a little red dot, the infrared glow, and it's usually for a fleeting second. And that infrared glow is like a camera flash, except it's in a portion of the spectrum that we humans cannot see. But what I think is happening is the coyotes, when it sees that red dot, they see the flash. So we were seeing tracks in front of the cameras, but the camera wasn't fast enough to get the coyote. So we need to actually find a way of luring them in and kind of holding them on site a little bit. So that was one of our projects. The other project that we had was dealing with coyotes and sea turtles. And I have Marcia Kopp, who is going to come up right now and talk about that aspect of the program.
Well, it began a year ago this past spring in one of our classes that Ken was teaching. It came to our attention that there were sea turtle nests that had been predated up at Sebastian Inlet to the tune of, I think, something like 300 nests had been entered and predated by coyotes. They were sure it was coyotes. And then south, down in Martin County, was another 100 or so nests that had been predated. So we decided that it would be interesting and advantageous for us to do a study out on these St. Lucie County beaches. So we went and started on South Hutchison Island and primarily focused on Walton Rocks because it's very densely, there's a lot of dense vegetation there, and it's set back in remote, and there's not very many structures. There's not very many people around there. So we decided to set up wildlife cameras on the beach to see if we could capture a coyote coming to to dig up sea turtle nests. We would have to go and put the camera out sometime around early evening and then go and retrieve the camera, cameras, we were using a couple of them, first thing in the morning, because there was always a chance that somebody might come along, see them, and, you know, take them. So aside from that, we didn't really ever find any coyotes captured on our camera. We also looked for evidence of scat, coyote scat, and if you've ever studied scat, you can identify, you know, what a coyote would leave, what it looks like. And paw prints. We never saw any evidence of coyotes in that area along those beaches. We also went down to Ocean Bay Hammock and up to Frederick Douglass. But what we did see was a lot of predation by raccoons. The raccoons were literally tearing up the sea turtle nests at Walton Beach. An observation was made by us, the team, that there may be more than the usual amount of raccoons there because of the trash and litter that we were seeing along the parking lot. So we made some recommendations. We ended our study, I think we started in March, and we ended it sometime around the end of August. Obviously, there was not any evidence of coyotes, but we were, you know, relatively sure that eventually coyotes would find their way over to those beaches. Maybe, maybe not. There are more people living along those beaches than elsewhere. So we focused on trying to get something done about the litter problem and the raccoon predation. So Ken contacted somebody,
mosquito control,
and they put up signs and secured the trash cans. And I was out there earlier this year, and everything looked a lot better. So the bottom line was we did not find any coyotes there. However, they did turn up on North Hutchison Island at Avalon Beach State Park. Ken was out there, I was out there. It was proven that the coyotes had been there and predated sea turtle nests. So that was turned over to the park manager there, and our job was done, basically. What we needed to do was to get out and establish whether or not there was an issue with coyotes on the deep beaches, digging up the sea turtle nests, and so with that accomplished, we ended the project.
So the Coyote Watch program on our beaches was conducted by Marcia Kopp. She was the project manager, Jerry Bott, Melissa Jansen, and Luann Hastings. And we're all familiar with the site. St. Lucie County is prime territory for three endangered or threatened species of sea turtles. We have loggerheads, which are threatened, and then we have greens and leatherbacks, which are endangered. So we are critical habitat for those three species. And we were hearing from Indian River County in 1 year, back in 2013, they had 344 sea turtle nests that had been preyed on by coyotes. Much of that was in Archie Carr, but it was spread throughout the entire county, including Round Island, which is just over the border of St. Lucie. So they were found throughout the entire county, and they had to implement a coyote management plan. So even though they still have predation on sea turtle nests occurring, the numbers have been reduced. We also knew that Martin County had some issues with coyotes. And on Hope Sound Beach, they had predation of sea turtle nests in the past, and it was fairly substantial. They found that there were only 12 documented nests so far this year, but in previous years, there were considerably more than that. So we found that to the north of us, Indian River County beaches had coyotes. To the south of us, we had Martin County beaches that had coyotes. And then we also know that strip of savannas, which is just to the west of our barrier island, they also have coyotes there. and the state park manager there confirmed that. So the question was, what about sea turtles in St. Lucie County? What kind of impact? And we heard from Marsha that we did not find any impact on the beaches that we monitored until we got to North Hutchinson Island, and it was just south of the Indian River County line, and we did find coyotes. And this is Marsha studying the problem. We were out of Adams Ranch doing some work. So we used those four remote beaches, and then we set up trail cameras. And these trail cameras were well camouflaged. This was the only one that we used that had a white PVC pipe. The rest of them we had that were spray painted green. And we tried to place them in the shrubbery. We, of course, had permission to do this. We had it out at FP&L. We had permission from that site as well. And when we were working with the trail cameras, when the flashes go off, we were finding, we had to work a little bit at this to figure out, you know, how to get the best pictures. When the trail cameras were flashing, they were illuminating all the vegetation around us. So we had to put the cameras on these poles and extend them out and over the vegetation, because when the flash goes off, we need it to illuminate the beach and not the vegetation directly in front of it. So, you know, we had to practice a little bit on getting camera angles and so forth. We didn't lose any cameras. Luckily, we didn't lose any. They're kind of expensive. The only issue that I had when I was out putting the trail cams up, I was walking down the beach with the camera on a pole, and then I got down on all fours, and I was using my hands to dig into the bushes a little bit, into some of the sea oats. There was a little area between some sea oats. And I made a little hole, and I was putting my camera up, and somebody had called in a sea turtle nest poacher. So luckily the folks out at Avalon, they knew I was going to be out there that day, but the people did come down and they did stop me just in case, and they knew it was me. And luckily when they stopped me, it had just started downpouring and they got me a ride back. So I actually appreciated them doing that. But this was the sort of location that we were looking for. And when we were baiting, you know, we've had to learn about this whole process ourselves. One of the recommendations that we received from the University of Florida specialist down in Fort Lauderdale, he recommended using an artificial sea turtle nest. So the whole idea is to find the coyotes that are actually predating on the nests. Coyotes, it's a learned behavior. So once a mama learns how to destroy and eat the eggs of sea turtles, she then teaches it to all of her offspring. But not all the coyotes have that learned behavior. So what we had to do is we could target the ones that know how to do this. So the way you target it is by putting up the game cameras or traps or other setup by creating an artificial sea turtle nest. And what you do is you know exactly where it is. You make it a shallow excavation of the sand, and then you use chicken eggs and you put them in and then you cover it up. And as the eggs start to spoil, it gives off that rotten egg smell, and the coyotes can smell it and they'll come to that one area. And they've been trained by learning from other coyotes. So those were the ones that you would actually want to target. The ones that are out there just roaming, not creating a problem on sea turtle nests, they could not be impacted at all by the hunters or trappers or even by our cameras. It was the ones that we had to get that were actually causing the damage to the sea turtles. So you see what the coyote tracks look like. This is what we found. This was the evidence that was the giveaway that showed that it was not raccoons, that it was not dogs. And when you look at that, they're an exact matchup. We had the cameras aimed at the exact location. The flashes were going off. They were taking pictures. But the only way that we were definitely to confirm this was by catching a few good prints. It's a little hard to tell in this photo because, well, let's see if I can go back. It's a little hard to tell in this photo, but it looks like it might have been the hind print. You know, when you're on sand, it starts to collapse on its own. So if we had gotten out there a little bit more when it was moister, a little earlier in the morning, we would have had a little bit firmer print. But you can definitely tell that it was coyote. You just can't tell if it was front or back. So we'll leave it up to you to determine if it was good, bad, or the ugly about coyotes.